Welcome to Eye Care Central. This is a short video in which we will be discussing lens transparency and cataract formation. A healthy crystalline lens is a transparent structure. Many factors are responsible for maintaining its transparency. We will discuss them one by one. First is the peculiar arrangement of lens fibers. Lens is made up of three layers: the outer capsule, the anterior epithelium. Lens does not have a posterior epithelium, because during embryological development, the posterior epithelium gives rise to the primary lens fibers. I have discussed this in detail in my video on the anatomy of the lens. You might want to check it out if you are not familiar with lens anatomy and development. So the third component of the lens are the lens fibers. Lens fibers fill up the entire cavity of the lens. These lens fibers are uniformly arranged and tightly packed. This tight packing ensures that little or no extracellular space is present between these cells. Also, the size of an individual lens fiber is less than the wavelength of light. Because of the phenomenon of destructive interference, there is no backscattering of light, making the lens a transparent structure. Also, the lens fibers present in the center of the lens are the oldest and also the most mature. Mature lens fibers lack organelles like nuclei, mitochondria, endoplasmic reticulum, etc. And this absence of organelles also reduces light scattering and contributes to lens transparency. It is also important to note that the lens is devoid of any blood vessels, which means that it is an avascular structure. The lens gets its nutrition mainly from the aqueous humor and partly from the vitreous humor. It does not have any arterial supply or venous drainage. This lack of blood vessels also provides clarity to the lens. The composition and arrangement of lens proteins also play an important role in lens transparency. Lens is made up of proteins. These proteins can be water-soluble or water-insoluble. Water-soluble proteins are known as crystallins. They make up 90% of the total protein content of the lens. There are three types of crystallins: alpha, beta, and gamma. Beta crystallins have the highest concentration in the lens at about 54%, followed by alpha crystallins, which are about 32%, and gamma crystallins are least abundant at about 1.5%. Alpha crystallins are the largest of these three in size. Lens proteins are densely packed together, and this arrangement of proteins is not only responsible for the refractive index of the lens, but also for its optical properties. Alpha crystallins also have chaperone function. Chaperone means something like a supervisor, someone who takes care of others. So alpha crystallins act as chaperones, which means that they prevent the lens from any oxidative damage, they prevent the apoptosis of the cells, prevent protein aggregation, and also help in the remodeling of the cytoskeleton. Now the lens is exposed to light and radiation energy of different wavelengths all the time. Crystallins absorb radiation energy, mainly the shortwave visible light, UV light, and infrared radiations, thus protecting the lens enzymes that are present in the internal layers of the lens from radiation-induced damage. The remaining 10% of lens proteins are water-insoluble proteins. They are known as albuminoids. During cataract formation, the soluble protein content decreases, while the insoluble protein content of the lens increases. In fact, it has also been seen that the structure of albuminoids very closely resembles the structure of alpha crystallins. So it is hypothesized that the alpha crystallins get denatured and converted into insoluble albuminoids during the process of cataract formation. Lens transparency is also maintained by the presence of antioxidants. There are enzymatic and non-enzymatic antioxidants present in the lens. The major enzymatic antioxidants are superoxide dismutase, catalase, glutathione peroxidase, glutathione reductase, glutathione S-transferase, thioredoxin system, etc. Non-enzymatic antioxidants are reduced glutathione, vitamin C, vitamin E, beta-carotene, etc. These antioxidants act by neutralizing the free radicals that are generated during oxidative stress, and it has been seen that decline in the activity of all these enzymes and molecules occurs during cataract formation. Aquaporins also contribute to lens transparency. Aquaporins are proteins that act as water channels. The aquaporin present in the lens is aquaporin 0, which is also known as MIP26 or major intrinsic protein 26. We know that increased water content can lead to separation and disorganization of lens fibers, which leads to lens opacification. Aquaporins maintain the lens at a relative state of dehydration at about 70% water content, presence of membrane pumps and gap junctions. Membrane energy pumps and gap junctions maintain the osmotic and the ionic homeostasis of the cells. They maintain the lens in a dehydrated state by creating an osmotic gradient across the cell membrane. Sodium and calcium ions are pushed out while potassium levels are maintained intracellularly. This creates a hypoosmotic intracellular environment and fluid flows out of it along the osmotic gradient. Increase in the levels of sodium and calcium along with marked loss of potassium has been implicated in the pathogenesis of cataract. The type of cataract most commonly associated with calcium overload is cortical cataract. Pathogenesis of cataract. The most important factor that has been implicated in the development of cataract is oxidative stress. Oxidative stress leads to the formation of free radicals and peroxides that cause the breakdown and denaturation of proteins, cross-linking of proteins and loss of lens transparency. These free radicals can also damage other cellular components like lipids, DNA, etc. Oxidative stress also causes direct damage to the lens membrane, leading to loss of membrane pump function. Cataract formation occurs when the rate of production of reactive oxygen species exceeds the rate of their removal. With aging, there is reduction in the potency of antioxidant mechanisms. Oxidative stress can also occur due to various metabolic conditions like diabetes, galactosemia, etc. and environmental factors like radiation exposure, heat, UV light exposure, etc. Other causes of oxidative stress and osmotic imbalance are nutritional deficiencies, trace metal deficiencies, smoking, toxic substances like drug abuse, alcoholism, etc. Pathogenesis of a diabetic cataract. Lens utilizes glucose for energy. This glucose is primarily metabolized by the process of anaerobic glycolysis. However, in conditions that cause glucose overload like diabetes mellitus, this glucose is directed towards the polyol pathway. In this pathway, the enzyme L-dose reductase catalyzes the conversion of glucose to sorbitol. Sorbitol collects within the lens and it cannot diffuse out due to its polar character. This creates a hyperosmotic effect that results in fluid influx and lens hydration. Also, during this conversion of glucose to sorbitol, depletion of cofactor NADPH occurs. NADPH is required for the regeneration of reduced glutathione, which as we know is a major antioxidant. This contributes to increased oxidative stress and lens opacification. Also, sorbitol is further converted to fructose by the enzyme sorbitol dehydrogenase. Accumulation of fructose, just like sorbitol, also increases the osmotic pressure inside the lens. This step also leads to depletion of cofactor NAD, leading to oxidative damage. Also, increased glucose level in aqueous humor can cause glycation of lens proteins, leading to the generation of free radicals. Formation of free radicals causes irreversible oxidative damage to the lipids present in lens membrane. This induces disorganization of the membrane, fragmentation of soluble lens proteins, and damage to critical membrane structures, apoptosis of epithelial cells, leading to increase in lens opacity and changes in the refractive properties of the lens. So this was all about lens transparency and cataract formation. Please like and share this video with your friends and colleagues if you found it useful. And please subscribe to my channel to support free education. Thank you very much.